the high desert and the great American Southwest, I bid you good morning, good afternoon, good evening, wherever you are in the Earth's 25 time zones, each and every one covered by a warm blanket. Well, maybe tonight not so warm. Called Midnight in the Desert. I'm Art Bell. Great to be here. I have but two rules on the show, so simple, right? Monday through Thursday, anyway. No bad language, and only one call per show. Beyond that, virtually anything goes. Okay, so I've got a kind of a cute story for you. Sometimes, occasionally, at about, I don't know, 6 o'clock, 6:15, whatever, I will doze off on the couch, right? You know, you get those, you ever notice that middle of the day, you get a little, sort of a little dip, and then you come back up again? And anyway, that's the middle of my day, so I did, I dozed off. And I guess it was around 7 o'clock, and Aaron said, "Wake up, Daddy." So my 8-year-old Asia came over, not in position, and pushed me as hard as she could. "Wake up, Daddy!" And she thought it was the funniest thing she ever saw in her life, as, of course, I nearly, you know, had a malfunction of my body, right? Oh, God, she scared me. Anyway, you also may have noticed that all day long, if you watch CNN, if you subject yourself to that, all day long they've been playing an endless loop of this young, unfortunate 15 or 16-year-old girl in school who gets yanked out of her chair by a cop. Apparently she had refused to yield her cell phone. And it escalated to that, right? And there's a big argument. Cop might get fired now. And she got dragged across the floor. It was pretty bad, you know, slammed in handcuffs, I guess, on her belly by this big cop. And they've been just playing it to death, as they do with whatever they get their teeth into. Anyway, we were eating dinner, and I was reflecting on still being alive after awakening that way. And Asia has a seat that can see the TV in the background. Sound was down, but CNN was playing this thing again and again of this girl getting ripped out of, you know, in the classroom, right? Ripped out of the chair, drug along the floor, and then handcuffs slammed on. And she got real serious, and she looked at me, and she said, "Dad, what did she do?" And I said, well, I just didn't say anything for a second. I looked at her real serious, and I said, "Misspelled a word." Man, you should have seen her face. Ah, karma. Some of the stuff we're going to be talking about tonight. I am really concerned and worried. Oh, wait. I have a couple of stations to welcome to the network tonight. I would like to welcome WHKTAM in Norfolk, Virginia. And I assume that's the way you say it, right? 1650 AM in Norfolk, Virginia. I hope that's the way you say it. If I lived there, I would not like people to call it Norfolk. It's Norfolk, right? Anyway, if you're from the area, somebody will call me from there and let me know. Also, KBRC AM in Mount Vernon, Washington, 1430 AM. Welcome to the network. Now you'll be sorry. Last night, KABC in Los Angeles. Tonight, you too. So, welcome. Good luck. Boots on the ground in Syria. Okay, that is the refrain beginning to get signaled from the United States. It looks as though our president, who was completely, absolutely against the idea of more boots in Iraq or Syria, is now seemingly changing his mind. I guess because of ISIS. But you have to consider the soup in Syria for you to understand how incredibly dangerous this is. And I do agree. We may have to have boots on the ground in Syria if we're going to have any real effect. But you've got Assad, right? Then you've got the rebels trying to overthrow Assad, right? Then you've got the Russians who are on the side of the government, Assad, and they're bombing the rebels for the most part, right? Helping us to death. Meanwhile, we're trying to help, well, all kinds of people. We're trying to help anybody fighting, and it's not many, by the way, ISIS. And, of course, in Iraq, we're trying to help the Kurds. And the whole thing is a dangerous mixture that could explode into World War III. When you have American planes, and we're talking about a no-fly zone, too, American planes and Russian planes, you know, splitting wingtips, somebody's going to let loose with a missile, and something is going to go horribly, horribly wrong. So, there you have it. That's my opinion. I think it's dangerous. And here's some more dangerous stuff. Our U.S. Navy sailed a warship, and it's a good thing we did, past one of China's big artificial islands. Have you seen those? In the South China Sea on Tuesday? I have a question for you. If you build an island where there was not an island before, does that make it, well, in this case, I guess not a new country, but otherwise, if you put an island where there was not an island before, is it real? Can you call it a country? Can you hoist a flag, threaten to attack the U.S. and make, you know, get foreign aid? Anyway, this is no joke, really. It's in the Spratly Islands, claimed this section by the Philippines. And what they did is they went to kind of a high sand dune, I guess, and built an island. It's pretty big. So we sent a Navy warship with our flag sailing by. They warned us, said, get away from our airspace. They claimed 12 miles. Can you claim 12 miles around an artificial island? I think it's a good question. Because is it really there? The only reason it's sticking out of the water is because a bunch of Chinese went out there and built it up, right? The Cassini spacecraft is about to get an icy shower. It is going to do something really interesting. It's going to go right through frozen particles that are erupting from the South Pole and Cladus, one of the moons, one of Saturn's many moons, actually. And it's going to go through frozen moisture. Now, it's going fast, 19,000 miles an hour. So it's going to go through it really quickly. Nevertheless, it's dangerous. Hopefully it makes it through. One more item from the Anomalist. It seems that cosmonauts, Russians, got more than their fair share of anomalous experiences while orbiting Earth in the early years of the Russian space program. As we learn more, as reports come out of Russia that we didn't get before, everything from seeing a disappearing island, I like that one, in the Indian Ocean, as they watched, to even stranger accounts of bizarre occurrences they called the Space Whisperer. Now, what would that be? Go home. Go home. I don't know. All right, so coming up in a moment, we have Trish Owen. In 1991, Trish Owen opened the Goddess and the Moon, a metaphysical shop in downtown Nashville, Tennessee. Country music stars Taylor Swift, Reba McEntire, Keith Urban, and Trisha Yearwood have had her perform at divination parties. How about that? The Atlantic City Tourism Board, Showtime Network, Dell Computers, and many more have hired her for readings as well. And, you know, as I read this, I wondered, what did Dell want with her? And did Showtime put a, you know, a curse on HBO? Dell Computers, who knows what they might have been up to. Anyway, she's been a fixture at Cheryl Kenyon Romance and Fiction Writer Conventions. Really? On November 2nd, she will appear at the A&E show Cursed, in a five-part program about the Bell Witch, nice name, huh, who is a local legend. Tish has appeared on radio, TV, been featured in magazines and newspapers, writes, and is editor of Green Egg Magazine, the oldest pagan magazine in the country. She is also a host on Green Egg Radio. Tish is a practicing witch and has been for 20 years. She has performed at a pagan church, serving pagans in religion and life. She is the coordinator for Pagan Unity Festival, a four-day event in Middle Tennessee that is 18 years old and draws people from all over the country. Pagan authors, practitioners of magic, we're going to be asking about that, music and workshops fill the weekend. This happens every May. Tish also coordinates Spirit Fest, a metaphysical event that is now in its fifth year and happens every October. She was part of the response to my request for a spellcasting, cauldron stirring, and so forth and so on, which you get the idea, right? So we'll see about Trish in just a moment. You're listening to Midnight in the Desert. Cruising through the night. Actually, blasting through the night. I'm Art Bell.
Strike 12, and Midnight in the Desert is pounding packets your way on the Dark Matter Digital Network. To call the show, please direct your finger digits to dial 1-952-225-5278. That's 1-952-CALL-ART.
That'd be the number, but not right now. Hold your calls. Here comes Tish, and oh, by the way, you might want to go to my website and look at a picture of Tish. You want to see a picture that'll make your blood run? Well, that might be going too far. But, pretty scary, actually. Trish Owen's picture is, make your blood run cold, but it may, depending on what kind of fifth grade teacher you had. Hi, Tish. Welcome to the program.
Hi, Arda. Trying to stop laughing.
Good, because this is serious business.
That's right.
So how, I guess I just read, but I mean, you've been a witch how long now?
About 25 years.
25 years. All right.
About 25 years and, started looking, I practiced it as a religion and as, witchcraft, which I think it's all kind of mixed together. But I started looking when my children were young and I became rather disenfranchised and disenchanted with the Catholic Church.
Oh, really? You are a Catholic now turned witch.
There's a lot of us. You have no idea.
Actually, I might. And the Catholic Church and witchcraft and paganism actually have a lot in common when it comes to... Well, they do.
That's true. They do. They're just pagans with really good buildings and more money.
Nice windows.
Nice windows. Right. Beautiful. Yes.
All right. The big question for me is witchcraft real?
Well, I certainly hope so.
You're in a position to answer that more than I am. I hope it is.
I hope it is. I believe it is. I practice it. We, you know, this is full moon, as a matter of fact, tonight. And so before I came home to come and talk to you, I participated in full moon ritual. And what we did in ritual tonight was we have a list. We have a working list. And we also have on Facebook, we have a page that is about changing the world through magic. And we think that because we're witches and we know how to tap in to the power and to utilize it, that we can create change in the world. And so for the next 2 weeks, we're working on ending religious persecution.
That's a good thing to do, I guess.
Well, and it's not, you know, so we're putting the energy into it.
I was personally hoping you were burning somebody at the stake and skinning somebody alive at the same time on the other side of the room.
We don't have good enough fans for that. we can never get the smell out.
That's a good answer. But
we did have a cauldron. We did have a cauldron.
Seriously?
Yes, of course. What are you going to burn things in?
Or people.
Well, you have to have a little tiny person because it's not a very big cauldron.
You know, without asking you specifically what you mix up in a cauldron, what are you making?
Well, it depends. It depends on what you're doing. We actually made a list of things that we would like to go away. And we kind of put the energy into it and lit it on fire and threw it in the cauldron. I've seen soup cooked in a cauldron. That was very good, by the way. So it depends. So herbs and...
A soup of who?
Dolls.
I'm sorry?
A soup of who? A soup of who?
Yeah.
tiny tender babies, but we only use organic local.
I'm messing with you. You know, what I guess I really want to know, Tish, is whether magic is real.
I believe that it is real. I've seen some pretty amazing things. I feel like that we have been able to, or I've been able to, change the course of things because it is just using energy. We all have the power to pull in energy and utilize it. Why do you think people pray, Art? Because
same reason, yeah. I agree. Same reason.
Same Absolutely. Reason. It's the yeah. same reason. And you can, we have a little more bells and whistles because we have cauldrons, but you utilize the energy to affect change, to bend things to your will, to make things better or to make things happier.
All
or
right.
make
Let's go
healthy.
Down that. Let's
or,
go da- right. Let's go down that road. Bend things to okay. your will.
Yes.
How about bending people to your will?
I don't recommend it.
I didn't ask your recommendation. I said, can you do it?
Can you do it? Okay, so let me just say that when you are bending someone to your will, you are very probably bending them against their own free will, which
Absolutely.
Is a very difficult thing to do. You better make sure you want to do it. And I've seen people do a love spell. You think that's a pretty innocuous, fairly simple thing. But a girl I knew did a love spell, and she absolutely would not be talked out of it, and then it took her 3 years to get rid of the guy once she figured out she really didn't want him.
Yeah. Well, that's usually the way it works out in movies. Love spells are cast. And
well, it works out that way in real life, too.
That's right.
The thing about doing any kind of magic spell is magic, once you fire it and let go of it, can go in three or four different directions, several of which you didn't intend, one of which might be downright pleasant, and one of which might actually work. And so I advise people to pray like a lawyer.
Yeah, pray like a lawyer.
Well, get your words out there. Here's exactly what I want, because the universe, I feel, and you can do whatever you want to with that, I feel the universe is a place of neutrality, and so what you ask for, you get. That's why being negative is not such a good idea. Being positive is a better idea. You know, don't be mean to your, don't kick your neighbor's dog. All those kinds of things.
Yeah, but okay, I'm going to lay the same thing that I have on other witches on you. If somebody's coming after you, Trish, and when I say coming after you, I mean, I don't know, stalking you, maybe trying to break into your place and knife you or choke you to death, or, you know, coming as if somebody's coming after you and you had to use witchcraft to go after, you know, I mean, a good defense is a very good offense, right? So if you had to go after them to do something to them in that extreme circumstance, could that be done?
Yes.
Okay, so if I want somebody to to die a horrible, painful, twitching death, I would have to give up a lot of karma to get that achieved.
Yeah, you would. And do you really think you have the right to do that?
Yeah, it depends.
Okay, it depends. I'm not going to recommend it because, yes, I do. And I've had people say, oh, karma, you're silly, you're being ridiculous. But I have seen karma, and I've seen instantaneous karma, and I've seen quite awful karma.
Yes.
And so I absolutely have to believe it. So somebody's going to have to really do something really, really bad for me to want them to die in a fire.
Yeah, that's bad. That's bad.
So I again don't recommend it. But have I seen people have, you know, I've done a couple of things. I have no shame.
We've all done things we're not proud of.
Well, no, I'm not ashamed of it. I felt like I was justified. When somebody does something to you or hurts you or screws you or, you know, now if somebody is coming after me to hurt me now in this immediate moment and they're running toward me, I'm going to reach over here and pick my gun up.
Good for you.
I'm not going to throw a fireball at them. So, because
it'd be cool if you could throw a fireball, though.
Sadly, it could. It would be so awesome. But sadly, I cannot.
Okay,
but
so I understand you can't throw fireballs, and if you said you could, then we'd have a problem program going on here. But if you can sort of throw a fireball of intent, and I think that's what we're really talking about here,
that's
Trish.
That's exactly what we're talking about.
And when you pray in church, it's intent. I did some experiments, and I'm going to only bore you for a second, audience. Years ago on another show, in another universe far, far away, I did some, you know, I got involved with the university, Princeton, that's doing this experiment, and they set up an experiment with me. Then, Trish, I went far beyond that, and I began to attempt to control the weather in locations, and I did so successfully, time and time again. And these weren't the wussy kind of changes. These were areas that had no prediction of rain and needed it desperately, that kind of thing. And we actually created rain. It was astounding. I was working with millions of minds intent on one thing. I don't know anything about how intent works, except I did a total of 10 or 12 experiments, about 10, I think, including one for somebody who was very, very ill. Couple, actually, and those worked as well. So I got to the point where it began to scare me. For one thing, I thought no single person should have that much power, and for another, people were suggesting to me that I try and move a hurricane, which I thought, boy, could that go the wrong way. I'll move it back out to sea, it'll get more strength, and then really hit. And then, you know, in other words, unintended consequences. And that's something that can happen with what you do for your work, right?
I absolutely agree. And to say, you know, there's a show on ABC, we'll plug them, Once Upon a Time, and the bad guy says all the time, magic comes with a price, dearie.
Yeah.
And he's right. It does. You have to understand what you're doing. You have to understand what the ramifications might be, which you did. You understood that you could move it or send it back or whatever, and it would make never what you intended.
Yeah,
it would make things a horrible time.
Yeah, I didn't know enough about what I was doing to go forward without risk. But what I did find out, Tish, is that it's real.
It's real.
Oh yeah, it's real. Now, Try to answer this one for me, Tish. Do you think it matters or makes a difference if there is one mind projecting strong intent about something, or there are millions of minds projecting the same intent at the same time? Is one force greater than the other?
Yes, because there's strength in numbers, I believe. I feel like there is. And on a small scale, talking about the weather, because we have a festival that we do in May. And in May, in Tennessee, you can have anything. You can have straight line winds. You can have tornadoes. You can have beautiful, sunny 80 degrees.
Sure.
You can freeze to death. I mean, it runs the gamut. But what you would prefer not to have is the kind of rain that we sometimes get. And so if you put a bunch of people with the same mindset, and they have to have the same exact same idea, or it works much better if they do, of moving this storm, just gently moving it so that it would split around us. And it did, not just once. We've been doing this Pagan Unity Festival for 18, coming up on 19 years, and we've done it many times.
You know, though, here's
get some relief.
Yeah, I get you. But here's what I worry about, Tish. You could move the storm into an area with a higher concentration of moisture in the air, or more preheating, and instead of being a storm that now misses your festival or whatever it is, it becomes a tornado and comes down and destroys 50 mobile homes.
Okay. So would you like to know how we did it?
You mean safely?
It's old magic. It's old folk magic. But you take an axe.
All right.
Head.
Hold on. Hold that thought. Okay. Hold that thought, Tish. We're at a break.
Okay. All right.
Tish Owen is my guest. And we're going to explore the world of curses coming up. There's so much to talk about. Our love is a flame.
Take a walk on the wild side of midnight. From the Kingdom of Nye, this is Midnight in the Desert with Art Bell. Please call the show at 1-952-225-5278. That's 1-952-CALL-ART.
My guest is Tish Owen. She is a witch, and I think she is the real McCoy. Back to her now. Tish, welcome back. You were going to say you safely whisked this little storm away.
Well, we didn't really send it somewhere else. We used folk magic, heel magic,
mm-hmm.
Appalachian magic, all those things. And we buried an axe head. Buried the axe head, split the storm. Just split it around us. Very gently.
You buried an axe head?
We did. In the direction from which the storm was coming.
Cool. And it works
like a charm.
Really? All right. Let's switch topics a little bit.
All right.
Is it possible or not to put a curse on a person or an organization?
It is. It takes an awful lot of work, concerted effort, the willingness to put aside your moral compass.
Mm-hmm.
And take whatever karma comes from you, or mm-hmm. comes to you.
Well, if you get angry enough, that's no problem.
Well, if I get angry enough, I'll just kneecap them and go down the road. But the amount of effort that is put forth for a curse. Okay, so there's spells.
Yes.
And there's hexes. Not
are these
bad.
All?
And then there's curses.
These are all distinct things.
I think they're distinct things. In my estimation, they are.
Okay, then
somebody
please
may call
draw,
us and draw tell us that I'm wrong.
Okay,
but
draw for me the distinction between them, please.
All right. So spells are for all kinds of things. They're for jobs and houses and cars and monies and that your dog won't die and that your next-door neighbor will stop, cutting his branches and throwing them in your yard, whatever.
Oh.
For like a lot of things.
Practical things.
And for healing and for, helping people. And the one that we did tonight that we set into motion is to stop religious persecution across the board. Everybody just stop. And so that's a spell that we put into motion. A hex can be a very simple thing that you throw energy at someone that, they'll have a bad day or they'll stop doing what they're doing, and it's a little baneful magic. a curse, I feel like, is a whole big production to make this happen. And you, I think my question would always have to be, why? Why would you put forth the kind of effort and also reap the kind of karma that is going to come? And it is. You know it is. Or I know it is. I think it is.
Well, look, Tish, we've got people dressed in black right now, you know, over in Syria, lopping off heads and stuff like that.
Yeah, so, that's true.
So there are people, trust me, willing to go to the very, very darkest side.
And I think that that kind of does lend itself to the kind of magic that would be baneful that you would be willing to take the hit for, to stop these people.
Well, they're willing to take the hit, Tish, just to bring on, I guess, the center part of their ideology is to ignite Armageddon.
Oh, yes, absolutely. So how do we put together a curse that would be effective? Ooh, there's all kinds of things to think about.
I don't know. Yeah, I think you're already on a very tough track. If you did a whole spell tonight to try and stop religious persecution, there's going to have to be more of you. Because in all of man's history, there has been religious persecution. In fact, your folks, I think, were pretty much tied to stuff and then burned to death.
There were barbecues.
I understand that you folks are probably sensitive about the whole fire issue.
a little paranoid, just a little. Just kind of the Scarecrow in Wizard of Oz. A little paranoid about fire. But I agree with you. But this is something. This one issue, the religious persecution. We have several hundred and getting people more all the time on this Facebook group, and we say, here's what we're working on. Uh-huh. Here's how you need to visualize it. But also, write your letters, send your emails, because I really believe you have to do, you use energy and you to put a thing in motion, but then you have to do something practical. You know,
if you hope
Bernie Sanders wins the election, that's good, and you can do energy, but you have to vote for him.
Yeah. So witches can use social media, huh?
Well, we do.
Apparently,
we love social media.
Apparently, yes.
It's the greatest thing ever.
So it's like you could tweet somebody to death.
I'm sorry. That's the image of that is awesome. I may have to.
I'm sorry.
That was great. So he was, yeah. And we Twittered him to death. It was awful.
Yeah. Yeah, there you go. I mean, that is more people and more intent. There's no question about it.
It's true.
That's so interesting.
The more the better, and the more people putting energy into it. You know, once upon a time when I was a young Catholic girl, and the nuns would tell us, if you want something, if you need something, you should besiege heaven with your prayer.
Yeah.
And I see no difference. I'm besieging and putting the energy.
Well, I'll ask you about a difference, all right? You ready?
All right.
All right, so I imagine the young girl besieging heaven for something or another. And then I wonder if this same young girl, trained in witchcraft, in the very most powerful, darkest part of witchcraft, could, instead of beseeching, you know, up there, beseech whatever it is that you witches beseech, and which would be the more effective?
Okay, so if you're asking about besieging the devil, first of all, I don't believe in the devil.
No, I didn't say that.
So there's your first issue.
The devil.
but energy has two sides. You know, it's like the Force in Star Wars. There's a light side and a dark side.
All right.
It's two sides of the same coin.
Okay, fine. All right, so what do you worship?
I don't worship anything, because the energies that I work with do not demand worship. I work with...
That's a good answer, I guess.
It's a great answer. Which is why I gave it to you. But there are energies in the universe. There is, I believe, and you know what? That and a buck and a quarter will get you a cup of coffee almost anywhere. I believe that there is energy in the universe, that which is God, the unknowable, unobtainable, unfathomable energy, that which is God.
So you believe in God?
I believe that there's a God. Of course I do. There has to be. Well, I think there has to be. But because we can't imagine this force, this energy, we have to have something practical to hang our deity on. And so we have Jesus and Buddha and have Muhammad. And pagans have lots and lots. We have Thor and we have Odin and we have Zeus and we have Poseidon. It's awesome.
All right. Yeah, I know you got all those guys. All right, so, Tish, here's a question for you. You believe in God. You said that, right?
Yes.
And yet you worship others at the same time.
Phrase. No, that's fine.
Appeal to them for help or what you want.
Yes.
Okay.
Energy, yes, help, please help me, I need this.
So how does this fit into there shall be no others before me?
But it's all the same God, it's all the same energy.
Oh, you think?
I do.
I understand witches believe in, well, earth, fire.
Right. Definitely.
Let me tell you something just so we know what we're doing here.
Okay.
My wife, who's passed now, was a witch. So I know something about what I'm talking about.
Yeah, you know a little. I know you do.
A little, I do.
I think you know a lot, Art.
Well, a little. No, a little. I mean,
okay.
I picked it up. We had... there must have been 100 little black sacks around our house, hidden away in dark little corners, filled with black stuff.
Uh-huh.
And... I was told that it was a protective measure.
Uh-huh.
Anyway, so I do know a little bit about all of this, and I know that, you know, there is a dark side, or can be a dark side.
Sure.
To witchcraft. Now, when you want somebody to die a horrible, twitching, painful death, you don't go to the Catholic Church, usually.
No, not usually. You don't even go to the Methodist for that.
That's right. So you come to somebody like Tish.
No, because I'm not going to do that for you.
Well, you haven't been presented with the circumstances yet.
Okay,
maybe
right.
I can justify it.
But you know, if I'm not willing to take a gun and go and shoot them,
yeah.
Why would I be willing to try and make them die? I have a hard time.
Because it's way harder to prove in court, Tish.
Well, there is that. Oh, there is that. Oh, Art, you may have started something terrible tonight.
So then there's this karmic thing to look out for. In other words, what you do comes back 3 times or 10 times or whatever. What is it, 3?
Depends on... I think it depends.
Yeah.
So I would say at least 3.
All right.
Maybe 10, but let's speak conservative and say 3.
All right. Let us say that you issue the horrible twitching death thing on somebody. And then, of course, you're going to have to contemplate the karmic consequences. Is there anything you can do to mitigate these consequences? Can you set up a defense that will make perhaps what comes back at you not as painful?
I think that sometimes... in a lot of circumstances, magical and otherwise, that people try to make amends for the things that they have done. It doesn't always work. But karma is not, it's not God sitting on a throne in heaven punishing you.
No.
Karma is what you deserve. You set it up. You put it out there.
Yeah.
You created it.
Right, but that wasn't my question, though.
I don't think you can get away with it.
Is there anything you can do to mitigate the karmic consequences? Can you set up protective measures?
You could, but I don't think you'll be successful. Because what you're doing is you're fighting your own self, are you not? If karma is that you set up and you created, people act like karma is a punishment.
Well, it is
kind of,
right?
It's a lesson, right? But if you set it up and you set this in motion, then I don't know that you can defend from it. And then I'll tell you this, that a lot of people who do things, not killing people with horrible twitching death, but, you know, things that are very, very negative against other people may not believe it, that there's karma, or may not realize that there's karma until it's too late.
Yes, but somebody in your position would know. You would know if you were, for whatever terrible reason, you had to do something like that.
But I'd be willing to take the hit, too.
Well, still, would there not be some protective measures you could try?
I could try. There's a lot of things I could try.
Well, there you are.
I mean, there are. There's a lot of things that,
See, you... I didn't even know you were from the South till you said try.
Well, I am.
So how is it you're still alive? You're where exactly again,
I am in Nashville, Tennessee.
Nashville. Well, maybe there's protection in the music. Otherwise, you're in the South. And, you know, if this were 100 years ago and there was still radio, you wouldn't last the show.
Art, I've been held at gunpoint with shotguns. So.
Oh, seriously?
Oh, yes. Absolutely.
Because of your...
Because we scared the rangers at a park, and they thought that we were devil worshippers, and they came with shotguns cocked and loaded. And there ain't nothing like the sound of a shotgun being
20 gauge,
being chambered.
Getting racked, you bet.
Ain't nothing like it. It'll set you... it'll make you pay attention, I promise.
So they... caught you dancing around a cauldron or something?
Yeah.
Okay, see, if you go into a national park and you dance around a cauldron, you probably have to expect the possibility of upset people.
Art, we had a permit.
To do that?
Well, I don't think that
somehow
was
I doubt it.
Uh-huh. No, but we had a permit for the park area.
Really?
Yeah. We had a permit for it.
A lot of people have disappeared in national parks. You know that.
Well, right? It was a Nashville park. It was
Nashville park. Okay.
Yeah, and so it was. So we scared the rangers, and they came locked and loaded. So it was a rather interesting evening.
That's an interesting story. Period.
I caused a lot of trouble with that story. I just want you to know that.
Is that like in the middle of Nashville?
Yeah. Well, it's on the outskirts, but yeah. Now, this has been probably 10 years ago. I'm going to say it's been 10 years ago. Maybe not that long. And so I was, as you can imagine, I was really mad, but you don't tell men with shotguns that you're mad at them.
No.
You behave and you do what they tell you. And we did. But I did have a conversation, not really a conversation, but with one of the guys that was really castigating me and us on what we were doing, that we were turning the park, were we turning it into something else other than what it was supposed to be.
Uh-huh.
I'm not really sure. I thought it was for the people. And I said, you know, I tell you what, I'm willing to bet on which of us can get to your boss on Monday morning first. Because I'm going to bet it's me. And I wrote a really very hot letter, which ended up on the desk of the commissioner of the parks.
Mm-hmm.
And we had a meeting about it. And I ended up teaching a class to the rangers about what we were, what we did, and that we're not devil worshipers. And it ended up being very interesting, but really scary. I mean, really, really scary. I was scared.
All of that said, Tish, you do believe in the right of religious freedom.
I do.
So much so that you cast spells about it, right?
Mm-hmm.
So wouldn't that and couldn't that and shouldn't that include the right to worship the devil if you want to?
Hey, I don't have a problem. You know what? If that's what you want to do. But when I was 15 years old, my father, who was a good practicing Catholic, told me there wasn't the devil. And I believed him. And I still do. But if you want to worship the devil, if you want to worship a toaster or a Calvinator refrigerator, for by all means, have at it.
I like the idea of the toaster.
Like
there's
the
probably power
the
in a toaster.
The cult of toast.
The cult of toast. That's pretty good. All right. So it is possible to... We've got spells. We've got curses. And what was the third?
Hexes.
Right. Are there relative powers attached to each one of those that are different?
We have to know what you're doing, and you have to be willing to do it. And the thing about, I think, too, the difference with between a hex and a curse, and a hex is just hoping that something really terrible happens. And curses are more long-lived. Like, we've got the whole legend of the Bell Witch, and the land is cursed, and the descendants are cursed. And so a curse has a whole lot more ramifications of it than... But, I mean, people come in... Because I own a shop, and people come in to me on a regular basis to sit down and say to them, to me, I need to know if there's a curse on me.
Right.
Yeah, and so the first thing I say is, well, who have you really made angry? Who's really angry with you? Hmm. Well, nobody. Well, then you don't have a curse. You just have bad luck.
Well, I mean, that's probably a general truth. You don't make enemies, they don't make curses on you. But, you know, could be that you offended somebody in some way or in business or, you know, who knows, a million different ways, and you didn't even know you made them that angry.
But you ought to have a pretty good idea. And it's probably your baby daddy other girlfriend.
Well, I said organizations earlier, I was thinking of the curse of the Bambino, right?
Sure, yes.
You know that one.
Yes.
So that seems like one that was... Anyway, here we are at another break. Boy, that went fast. Hold on just a moment. This will be a short break, Tish. Back with Witchcraft. You really got to see Tish's picture. It's up at artbell.com. Take a look. Take a really good look.
Midnight in the Desert doesn't screen calls. We trust you, but remember, the NSA, well, you know. To call the show, please dial 1-952-225-5278. That's 1-952-CALL-ART.
Can't help it, that is so my favorite. That's my brother up there in Reno. Trish Owen is my guest, and she is a real... witch. This is Halloween week, folks, and we're going to cap it off on Friday with something that I have decided to call simply Dead Air. And I think you're going to enjoy it. It's going to be a little different this year, to say the least. Nevertheless, if you have a spectacular a ghost story that you wish to tell, email it, please, to me. ArtBell@KNYE.com. That's ArtBell@KNYE.com. And include your phone number for airtime, and if it's a cool story, I may call you. Once again, Trish Owen. Tish Owen. And don't miss her picture, by the way. Don't miss it. It's a really, really good, good picture up on our website.
You're going to make me self-conscious now about my picture.
It's a cool picture.
I thought it was cool, and now you're like...
It is cool. It is cool.
We're going to use it to scare small children, and so...
There's lots of good stuff to scare us. You hear my story at the beginning?
Oh, I did. That was so great.
You should have seen the expression on her face. She misspelled a word.
Oh... That is so... You're going to pay for that.
Her
face
just froze. Well, she had just... It's karma.
It's karma. So
the way she woke me up.
She's 16, and she's going to make you suffer for that. You'll have to teach her to drive. That will be your punishment.
That is punishment, too.
Yeah.
All right. So, if you wouldn't mind, not everybody knows, but they've heard of the Curse of the Bell Witch.
Right.
Tell the story as best you know it.
There are so many different directions that comes from, but basically the legend is there was a woman whose name was Kate Batts, who was a neighbor of John Bell. John Bell being very wealthy and had, you know, a bazillion acres that he got in a land grant, I think. And there was either A, they had a bad land deal between them, although there's no record of it. B, they had an affair and he jilted her. Again, there's no record of it. Yes. Or something else. And that she was a witch and she put a curse on him and cursed not only John Bell, but members of his family forever and ever ad infinitum, ad nauseum. And John Bell did become sick, but, you know, you have to look at everything that there was. I mean, cholera. If you stuck
now
yourself
you're scaring
on
me.
Pin,
I'm
going
to have to go. I'm going to have to go to the Green Leaf place and see if there's a relationship. Oh, I hope not.
And yes, you should. And members of the family suffered, and there was, you know, banging and clanging, and people got thrown against walls, and things went flying. But there was also a girl, a young girl, and so it could have been poltergeist activity, because that happens with teenage girls primarily. But, and there's, you know, oh, Andrew Jackson stayed there, and he said he would never stay there again. That's not true. There's no record of Andrew ever having been in that part of the country when that particular statement was made. So, but again, just like with the devil and many other things, the more energy put into a thing, I believe, again, I think, the more real it becomes. Is it funky? Does it feel weird? Yes. Is there something out there? Very probably. Because there's been so much negative energy put into this idea of the Bell Witch. But I will tell you this, and I want people that are willing to swear of it. The guys came in to film for this A&E show.
Mm-hmm.
Lovely people. We had about 20 people that were, you know, sound and lights and air and the whole nine yards. And when they left, after we kind of, you know, sat back and recovered of the six-hour shooting that we did, we had weird stuff happen in the shop.
Oh.
Weird enough that we're all kind of looking at each other going, you know, something's up. I mean, pictures falling, not just falling off walls, but falling off walls and landing in a trajectory across the room.
Oh.
Those kinds of things.
Seriously?
Well, yeah, for real. I mean, I'll give you a list of people. You can call them.
No,
and they'll say, yeah, it was kind of crazy. And so we started, you know, you start simply. You open the doors or windows or whatever, and you burn sage, which is, of course, Native American, and you do it in a counterclockwise fashion, and you try and chase out whatever it is, and you sweep grass to bring in good vibes and good energy. And, you know, because in some forms of paganism, Wicca, you call quarters and you ask for guardians to come and to protect the space, and you fill it with white light. And we did it, and we did it, and we did it, and we did it for about 2 weeks.
And?
Before it started to feel normal again.
Wow.
Yeah. So whatever you think or don't think or believe or don't believe, those guys have been out there tromping around. They had picked up whatever this entity, this energy, does not particularly like to be dealt with or revealed or the light shined upon it.
Right.
Okay, because Adams, Tennessee is a Liberty Town in Tennessee, and obviously, and there's not a lot of commerce there. There's not a lot of industry there. It has a very adorable little square. You would think for something as phenomenal and as wide-reaching, there's two or three shows on right now about the Bell Witch, that they would have, they'd have Bell Witch Day. They'd have, they would rebuild the old John Bell place and give tours. They would have shops on the square that would sell witch stuff. They don't.
And there's a good reason, because
they ain't stupid.
It's real.
I feel like there's, and I cannot tell you what it is, but something is there. And we dealt with a little tiny bit of it when these guys came in. I don't even know if they realized that they were carrying in this negative energy, but they certainly did, and we dealt with the aftermath. And I have not yet, I guess I probably should, get hold of the producers and go, hey, guess what, guys? Guess what we did for 2 weeks after you left? We cleaned up the mess. But that is exactly why there's not Bell Witch Day, I think, in my estimation, because people up there, it makes them nervous. And, you know, I'm not going to the Bell Witch Cave.
Okay, so here's a question for you. That would indicate it was a very strong whatever, curse, whatever.
Right.
So I'm going to ask you, you've been a witch a long, long time. There are many, many, many witches with less potential power than you have. There must be others with perhaps a lot more power. Would you think that would be true or not?
Sure.
Not?
Absolutely. Yes? Absolutely. But I also think that whatever happened with the John Bell thing, there's been a lot of energy put into it, and it's an ongoing.
Oh, yes.
People talk about it. We're talking about it. There's a TV show about it. People in Adams are scared of it. People, you know, that is a rite of passage in the state of Tennessee to drive up with a carload of other kids and go to the cave on the Bell property.
Huh.
It's a rite of passage. It's like drinking beer, having your first shot of Jack Daniels.
Yeah, but how can you be sure the passage won't be to the other side?
Exactly. I don't know that anybody's disappeared yet, but I don't know. I just feel like so much has been put into it over the last couple of hundred years that it is a real energy that is very negative and very nasty.
Why are curses so long-lasting as opposed to spells or hexes?
Because usually hexes and spells are for a specific purpose, like right now. And if you get mad at somebody and your boyfriend and he didn't do you right and you want to put a hex on him and have him not ever be able to have sex again or whatever.
Oh.
See, that's really mean. But
it
but
is.
They also, but also just normal wear and tear, things dissipate. You know, if you put a big balloon around your house, sooner or later, it would get holes in it from erosion and from the weather and whatever. So, spells and hexes are the same way. And usually hexes are kind of a short thing right now. Bam, I need to make you your, I don't know, left arm fall off, whatever. But curses are much more involved. They're much longer. They're much more horrifying. They're much more energy and usually hate and anger put into them. Because because spells are fueled by emotion. Everything is in the whole universe. But there.
Okay, well, here's one way to look at it. If this were a long time ago and you were up on a 2x4 hoisted above a bunch of burning stuff and you were about to be burned to death as a witch,
I would throw everything in me at them.
There you have it. There you have it. And
there
so
you have it.
That's some pretty powerful mojo headed toward the people out there clapping and having a good old time.
And so it should be. But I mean, there's legends of Irish curses that were put on Cromwell and the House of Orange, that there's all that emotion, that almost the death throes, that if they took everything and they killed everything and they even killed the dog, and you know, there's so much anger and emotion put into that. And so, you know, why do you think that in all the books and all the movies and all the stories that the wizards had magic words? Because words are powerful.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't have magic words. It wasn't abracadabra. It is, I'm gonna screw you up forever.
Yeah.
And it's powerful, and it is fueled and powered by raw emotion.
And maybe not just you, but your sons, your daughters, their daughters, and on and on.
I want them all, everybody in your line, I want them all to have horribleness. Now, boy, that's not something I would care to participate in.
Well, as I mentioned, though, if the flames are licking at your ankles, what the hell?
Doesn't matter, right?
That's right.
Karma is already here. It's at the door.
That's right. I suppose that karma could be projected upon some future life and some poor soul who would have no idea why he or she was being punished in this way. If you believe in reincarnation.
If you believe in reincarnation.
Do you?
Yes. I think it's the only thing that logically makes sense. I think that to be created and walk this earth and all we get is a 4 score and 10 and that's it, is not logical. A logical being who set things in motion, as I believe there is, would not. It's just not logical. And you can't learn in 70 years or 80 years or my mother's 98, so, you know, however many years you have, you can't learn all the things that you need to learn. You can't understand how, under all circumstances, that we treat people well, that racism is bad, that all those things. You can't have all the experiences. You can't learn everything you need to learn in 70 years or 80 years or even 98 years.
All
Isn't
right.
that a waste to not
yes.
come back?
Sure. You said that people have come to you to have a curse removed, and in most cases you don't think there's a curse upon them.
Right.
Have you found any cases where there was a curse upon them?
I do, besides Bell Witch, I do have somebody that I know who is absolutely convinced, and we go back to Ireland and we go back to Cromwell. And historically, looking up the documents, her family actually, and they were Irish, and they actually helped Cromwell, and they were cursed by the wise woman in the village as it burned. And I've never seen in my life anybody that has as bad luck as she does.
So that is somebody who has a curse. Have you attempted to assist her?
I have, but she's not cooperating with me. And then I have another friend who feels like she has one, again, a family, and she's taken steps to get rid of it and has people helping her work on it. So, because, I mean, everything can be undone except being dead. And then you come back anyway.
You're really convinced of that, huh?
Absolutely.
I'm really toyed with the idea myself. It seems logical, but there are problems with it. And one of them, of course, is the increasing population. We've gone from hundreds of millions to billions in a rather short period of time. So one has to wonder where, if you believe in such things, all the additional souls are coming from.
But don't you think that someone, that an omnipotent being can just make more, like Doritos?
Yeah.
If the Doritos company can just make more, I'm pretty sure that which is God can just make more.
Well, I guess, yes, you would imagine he could do anything. So
I would. Maybe not as tasty, but there you go.
All right. I've talked to a number of hypnotists who were very, very interesting, Tish. They took people back for various reasons.
Uh-huh.
And then stumbled into prior lives.
Okay. I do that as well.
It's really chilling. I mean, you take somebody back, and then you take them back, I guess, just a little too far, and suddenly they're talking about what seems to be another life, and actually, in some cases, Tish, they actually give details of that prior life that can be verified.
Yes.
You know, in this life, in now.
Right.
So,
because we have the Internet.
Well, we do know, yes, we do know.
And we can look stuff up.
That's right. So that is somewhat convincing to me.
It's convincing to me because, and you'll hear people, and I've heard people say, oh, doing regressions is just, you know, stupid because everybody will say, everybody says they're famous. Everybody is, you know, Anne Boleyn. Everybody is whoever.
Yeah.
Ivan the Terrible. And I have found that to not be true, and I've done, in 24 years, hundreds of regressions. I mean, honest to goodness, hundreds. Never have I done one that the person was famous. Ain't that a kick in the head?
Well, actually, it leads me to another question. I had no idea that you dabbled that much in hypnosis and particularly regression. So have you gone back intentionally looking for prior lives?
Yes.
Wow. How frequently do you have success doing that kind of regression?
With, like when clients come to me?
Yes.
I have only ever failed twice.
Holy smokes.
It's not a bad track record.
Or witchcraft smoke, whatever.
There you go, poof.
That's incredible.
I love it. I love the vicariously living through other people and for me, it's not just a, we're not just going on a tourist trip, okay? I send them back to the lifetime that they most need to see, that has the most information for them, that allows them to fix some things that are going on in the here and now lifetime.
Again, reference to karma?
Reference to karma or reference to patterns that you didn't know were there.
Wow.
And so to send them back into, and then to watch them when they come back and go, oh my gosh. That, oh my gosh. And so one of my absolute favorites was a girl, and I sent her back to the lifetime she needed to see. And so she's describing to me that, oh, she's a little girl and she's skipping down the road and her hair's in pigtails and she has on Sunday clothes and her parents are walking behind her, probably in the 20s maybe. Yeah. And they're on their way to church. It's a beautiful sunny day and a car comes up from behind them and like scoots around, or not scoots around, but swerves around the parents and hit the child and kill the child.
Oh my.
And so I said to her, because it's very helpful to see how you die, to help you process what's going on. And she would say, oh, it really hurt. I really hurt. And I said, I want you to leave your body and I want you to walk over to the car, because the man then hit a fence pole after he was drunk from the night before. It was early Sunday morning, still drunk. And he hit the fence pole, and I said, I want you to walk over and look at him. And she said, oh, I think he's dead too. And I said, okay. And I want you to understand and to be able to identify if you, in the here and now lifetime, know this man. And we can talk about it when you, you know, when you come back. And she said, oh, no, I know him. I know this man.
Oh, good Lord.
And she said, when she got done, and I brought her out of trance, and she said she was in foster care, and she was 10 years old before she was adopted.
Right.
The family into which she was adopted, the grandfather was the man, and I get chills talking about it, was the man that ran over her. And she said, he made me everything I am. He taught me everything I know. He waited for me. And I mean, I was just blood. I'm right here. I got chills running up and down my arms right now. Just recanting that story.
And I can imagine. Yes, amazing. I really can imagine. All right. So big question for you. This is an area of intense interest to me, this regression into prior mm-hmm. lives. Mm-hmm. So is it possible that a person under hypnosis, under such conditions, especially seeking you out and wanting this, has a preconception of what their prior life was? And I guess I'm saying, is there any way for you to be sure that when they're under, they're telling you the truth?
So I'm going to get really spooky now, because I'm seeing what they're telling. I'm seeing it. I've only had one person lie to me. I knew she was lying. I've only ever had two people that I couldn't get under, but psyche and spirit knows. So when you're in trance, and it's a very light trance, and I always say you're in charge of it, you're in control, right. You can wake up at any time, blah, blah. Spirit knows. And so if I am saying to you, and you're under, you're going to the lifetime that has the most meaning, that has the most bearing, the lifetime that you need to see, the lifetime where there are answers, the lifetime where you will find out what it is that you need to know to make improvements in your here and now lifetime. You're going to go there. I believe you're going to go there. And I've seen people be really surprised at who they were, where they lived. The only person that I can ever remember doing that was quasi-famous, and you had to know history, because he was the British commander, the English commander on Stirling Bridge, who always, and all of the and he did reenactment, he always dressed as a Scotsman. So he was not pleased.
That's okay. I don't need famous. I think that's all a bunch of bull anyway, for the most part, you know, because so many, when they go back, are, yes, as you point out, always somebody famous.
Right.
Nonsense.
Nonsense. Is absolutely nonsense, but there's always something to gain. I feel there's always something to gain. It's not just for fun and games. It's not just a tourist trip, there's purpose in it, and I love it. It's one of my favorite things to do.
What caught me about it originally was that some physicians that I talked to and interviewed did it by mistake.
Oh, my.
You know, actually took somebody back by mistake, just went simply went too far, and then began to get this information, and frankly, it scared the hell out of them.
I bet it did, because they were flipping out.
Yep.
And, oh, my gosh, how do we get them back?
But then they moved from that into investigation of the phenomenon.
Right.
You couldn't take somebody, could you, into, this is really a wild question, a future life?
I have never done it. I understand that people do it. I have not ever done it, and I'm not sure how to do it. So there's your honest answer. I don't know.
Okay. No, that's good.
Can I put a codicil here, or can I put a warning label on this? I'm trained, and I went to school, and I have a nice little nice piece of paper in a frame that says I am a certified hypnotherapist.
Okay.
Okay. As I started to get interested in this 20 years ago, I listened to a tape that a fella brought me where there was a bunch of people, and they were just playing around, and they knew just enough to be dangerous. And they put him under with no guidelines. When I put you under, you're safe. You can open your eyes at any time. Nothing can hurt you. You're only observing it. It's like looking at a movie, so on, so on, so on. He had none of those going in. He went into a lifetime where a lot of people got killed because he was having sex in the barn with somebody and wasn't at his post watching.
Oh.
I listened to 45 minutes of him sobbing. And people saying, you need to come back. You need to come back. How do we get him back? We need to come. It made the hair on my head stand up. And it made me so angry, I wanted to slap all those people. And so there must be safeguards. Because you are in there in somebody's psyche. You're messing around in their brain. There has to be safeguards going in. So I just wanted to throw that
out.
Yeah,
but okay. Isn't the whole goal to have them work this out?
But he didn't, and he was stuck, and they couldn't get him back.
Well, no, I get that. He was stuck, and he had done something awful, and a bunch of people died as a result.
Right.
But still, didn't he have to live that through?
Yes, I agree, but there was no... He was living it.
Oh, yeah.
He wasn't just observing it. He wasn't just looking at it like it was a movie. He hadn't been told nothing there could hurt him. He was standing there in about the third century and living it. And,
wow.
and so that's the difference. That's not how I would have handled it. But I also would have got him back. I've never had one I couldn't get back.
I'm happy to hear that. I always worry about that possibility.
They're just wandering around the third century.
That would be awful. If you couldn't get somebody back, you have essentially sent them back in time, and that's where they're going to remain if you couldn't get them back.
You couldn't get them back. I mean, they got him back eventually, but it was such a traumatizing event that, you know, we sat and talked about it on very numerous occasions and how it affected him. And so what I was able to do was to walk him through the life choices he had made in this lifetime based on that lifetime.
Uh-huh.
Because he was always a warrior. He was always a guardian. He was always a cop. He was a Vietnam veteran. He was always, in this lifetime, the warrior.
So when he came out of this, did he have detailed recollection of
yes.
what he went through? Really?
Yes. Yes.
Gee, that could almost give you PTSD, huh?
I mean, I have people cry. Absolutely. But I have people, I do readings for people and make them cry. So, you know, if I regress them, they're going to cry. But, I mean, I have people cry over what they saw or what they didn't see or what they lost or whatever, and I help them make the resolution with it so that they're not sobbing uncontrollably for 45 minutes and you can't get them to come back.
All right. Well, that's pretty powerful. I think evidence that there are prior lives, therefore there is reincarnation.
I believe it. I mean, I absolutely believe it, and a lot of people believe it. And across the world, as you know, more people believe in reincarnation than don't.
I heard that the Catholic Church actually at one time, taught...
To initiate a dialogue sequence with Art Bell, please coordinate your phalanges and call 1-952-225-5278. That's 1-952-CALL-ART.
All right. This woman obviously knows what she's talking about. Tish is her name. And Trish Owen, and you might want to join the conversation. So here comes the dreaded talk. If you want to call us, now's the time, and we'll sort of fit you in as we go along. It's area code 952-225-5278. Scrambling for a pencil? That's first you dial 1, then 952-225-5278. You're welcome to join us there and or by Skype. Skype is remarkably effective because it makes you sound more authoritative, because you sound so much better. So consider doing it if you've got an iPhone or an Android, whatever you've got. Doesn't matter. Even the pads, whatever. You know, as long as they can get Skype. And all you do is you go download Skype. It's free. And then when you become familiar with Skype, and you will fairly quickly, simply add us as a contact. Don't go to where you dial. That's the mistake everybody makes. Go to the little plus sign up at the top of Skype and then add a contact. And in this case, you would put in for North America, America and Canada, MITD 51, as in midnight in the desert, MITD 51. And then we'll be in your contact list. And you can call us anytime you feel like it. Just press that button, and it will dial from anywhere in the world free. Outside the country, the same ability exists, except it's MITD 55. Let me repeat that, MITD 55. And then it'll just be there in your contact list. It is so cool. We live in such a wonderful age where you can tweet somebody to death. Once again, here's Tish. All right, so Tish, as we gather people for you, let me first go over here. I get messages, you know, as we're on the air by computer through something called the wormhole, and I would like to ask a few of these, if that'd be all right.
Sure, it'd be great.
Tony asks, noticed in the picture that she has a wart on her chin in the spot. In the spot you would expect a witch to have it. Ask her if it's real.
It's a mole.
It's a mole. Okay, a mole, right.
It's a mole, and since this picture was made, I actually had it removed because it was changing shape and it was a little scary. Okay. So I don't have it. I kind of miss it.
Is it really in the spot you would expect a witch to have it?
Yeah. Go look at the picture.
Really? So why do witches traditionally have that on their chin in that spot?
Well, I think that it helps the mystique of witches being old and scary and living at the end of the lane in the deep woods and doing potions and curses and whatnot. And so, you know, to be ugly and have warts and moles, but... Yeah, it's not a word. It was a mole, and I do miss it, quite frankly.
All right. Art, please ask her to elaborate on the supposed curse on Cromwell and the curse on her friend that she's attempting to remove.
I'm not removing that one. She's getting help elsewhere, but
really?
For Cromwell, so the person that I know who was a member of a family who actually aided and abetted Cromwell's nefariousness in Ireland, the whole family was cursed, and they were cursed by, legend says, an old woman, an old medicine woman who did herbs and cures and purses and potions, and she may have had a wart. I don't know. That's not part of the legend. But that you and your family and generations will be, you know, cursed from now until forever. And, you know, I would say, and a lot of times when you see curses, especially in Hollywood and on television, they're always killing something. They kill a chicken or they kill. But since Cromwell had killed everything, there wasn't anything left to kill. So there wasn't an animal sacrifice made for that particular curse, but it was made with, you know, blood and guts and anger and emotion and hatred.
Is there additional power to be realized through animal sacrifice?
You know,
just tell the truth.
I don't know the answer. I don't know the answer. There are people that say yes, it does, but what I practice, why do I need to make animal sacrifice when everything comes from that which is God? Why would I need to?
Okay, let me tell you this. As a talk show host, I have listened to thousands of people, and I have learned over the years to very carefully listen between the lines. And I think that there's a lot that you know that you wouldn't talk about on the air.
Okay, so...
Would that be right?
Well, maybe. Although I'm a pretty honest person. But here's what I think. I think that if you think that killing a chicken gives power to your ritual, then it does.
Cool answer.
Because this is about belief, you know?
Well...
A better word, we'll call it faith.
Let me put it this way. If an animal sacrifice actually did, in what you do, add power, I wouldn't expect you to admit that on the air.
Okay.
Okay, and here's somebody who's coming at you, all right?
All right, I'm scared.
I wouldn't be. Basically, they're saying, where did I find you? It's like you're not the real thing, and someone maybe who thinks she's a witch but really is a fake. That's from Jeff in Portland, by the way, if you want to retaliate.
Well, you know, Jeff, I am in Nashville, Tennessee. I'm at 603 8th Avenue South every Tuesday through Saturday, and you can come on down, baby.
I like that answer. All right, let's take a few calls. I may go back to the wormhole. Wolfman on Skype, you're on the air with Tish.
Wow. Thanks for calling, Art.
I didn't. You called me.
Oh, that's right. I put a spell on to get on the show.
Okay. There you go.
I used a spell to get on the show.
Okay, yeah, I've got that.
It worked.
But it worked, obviously, because here you are.
It worked. Yeah, it did. I just had a coven meeting before the show, and I told them about your show. And I told them it was going to be on witchcraft tonight, and I didn't even know it was going to be on witchcraft. I was just guessing, and it worked. By the way, I was the guy who came up with Midnight in the Graveyard.
Okay, well, sorry we didn't use that. I fell in love with dead air, and that's what it's going to be.
That's all right. Well, maybe one time I'll do it from my graveyard at the farm, and you could... talk to me from there, and we could have a little bit of that.
Take your best shot. Weird. All right. Do you have a question for my guest?
Well, also, I have, for the tonight's show, I was thinking for your guest would be great witchcraft in the desert.
Okay. Okay, enough with the names. Do you have a question?
I was wondering what types of candles you use and what colors you use for which spells.
Okay.
Pretty traditional, really. We actually make for our shop, we actually make our own candles that we put the correct oils for what we're trying to create. We put a stone in each one of the candles, and they're reikied with energy for their particular purpose. There's also a label, and on the back of the label is an incantation. So, you know, typically is pink is for love, and white is for protection, and black is for banishing, and green is for money, and purple is to open your third eye and to do meditation. Brown is for animals, if you're doing something for your animals. Yellow is for power and energy. Orange, you'd use it for sexual energy. So, I mean, pretty traditional list. It's not rocket science, but...
Well...
It's the colors that correspond to the particular things that you're trying to create.
So you're saying just pick one for fun, orange.
Right, one for fun.
Well, okay, that's a way to put it. As you said, sexual energy.
Right.
To give yourself and or someone else additional sexual energy?
Yes, maybe you need a little perk up in your life, right?
Well, got the blue pill for that.
Well, there is the blue pill for that, but, you know, it has side effects.
Actually, now I hear there's a pink pill, too.
Yeah, candles don't have side effects. Which they don't, which the, only one in three is gets anything from it, so no, thanks. I'll pass.
Only one in three, huh?
That's what I heard it the other night.
I see. All right.
Yeah. It was on CNN, so you know it has to be true, right?
Don't get me started.
I'm sorry. A little joke. Have to make a little joke.
Yeah, that's fine. Kansas City, Missouri, probably. You're on the air. Hi.
Hi. You said something earlier about the huge population all of a sudden. Have you heard anything about indigo children or the rainbow children?
Yes.
Okay, that was my thought. And also, I had a question. My buddy Garrett wants to know if you can tell us a protection spell in detail.
Do we have time for that? It's radio. We can do whatever we want to. Okay, so first of all, maybe we should explain the indigo children, which is, theoretically, there's a lot of people that are coming in that are incarnating because we really need them to be enlightened and to help us to go forward as a species and not blow ourselves up. So, and I think I got that right. Correct me if I'm wrong. Protection spell. So, I would tell you to do this. I would tell you to go and get, you might have to look for this, but a black bag, a little black bag, a little satin black bag, hemlock, which is hard to find, but it's very effective, clove, some salt, a piece of jet stone. Zip it up, tie it up, don't ever open it, put it over your door.
Isn't hemlock poisonous?
It is. That's why you zip it up and don't ever open it.
Okay.
And so you can do that, and that's a really good one. I also like to burn a white candle because white is for protection. It dispels the darkness. If you've got somebody that's really, is this a physical protection that you are needing? Is it spiritual? What's the...
I'm not sure.
Okay, you just want a protection spell.
Yes.
Okay, so I would do the bag, but if you really... I'll give my website here in a little bit, and if you want to send me some email, you and I will correspond about this, and I'll help you out.
Okay, thank you.
All right.
Okay, salt. Salt across your doorways, salt across your window sills. And about once a week, vacuum it all up and put down more.
Okay? Really?
Because it repels negativity, all right?
Salt does?
Salt does, so start there.
Okay. Very interesting. So these things work.
These things work. And a lot of what we do and a lot of other people do are things that are in folklore. It's been handed down 10 million years. You know, just like the thing with the axe handle, probably not 10 million years, but where it's been handed down. And so if it didn't work, wouldn't we quit doing it?
One would think.
One would think because it is one of the signs of being insane, right?
All right. Well, so here's yet another question for you. And it is this. Is it possible to be a Catholic, let's say, a practicing Catholic, and listening to this show, realize that something you say does work, and give it a try without, you know, having to, unload in confession the next week?
I think that there are, I will quite frankly tell you that the number of people that come into my establishment, they're not all pagans. There's a lot of Baptists and some Catholics and, you know, whatever else, because they are desperate for an answer. And so they'll burn a candle or they'll do some incense or they'll do a spell. And I don't think that it's... I'll tell you a story. I had a girl that worked for me. Remember, I'm in the South. Had a girl that worked for me, and she was of mixed heritage, but she had been raised in Kansas, and so she was raised around white people. Mm-hmm. And so she worked for me on the weekends, on Saturdays. Very intelligent girl. Went to, as a matter of fact, is now in medical school.
Right.
And So we were there one day, and a bunch of little old ladies, and when I tell you little old ladies, I mean 60s and 70s little old ladies, and they were little African-American ladies, and they came in, and they wanted some of this, and they wanted some of that, and they wanted some, you know, we're going to put pepper in his shoes, and we're mm-hmm. going to do this, all of these different things that they needed that, for spell work, and candles, and some oils, and can you make me an oil to, you know, to make this guy go away, or to make my daughter's boyfriend leave, or whatever.
Right.
So, you know, we spent about an hour making stuff and doing stuff, and so they left, and I stepped outside, and I was sitting on the front porch, indulging in a bad habit, and so and this girl's about 16, 17, she came in, she said, can I ask you a question? I said, sure. And she says, all those ladies that just came in and bought stuff, they're not pagan, are they? I said, no, sweetheart, they're Baptist. And she said, I don't understand. And I said, in the South, there's a lot of people who really see no difference in the world or no difficulty in doing a spell on Saturday night and going and singing in the choir on Sunday.
Yeah, well, they're Baptists.
It's all the same thing.
They're Baptists who want action.
That's right, and they want it right now, and they haven't got time to wait. So, you know, yes, so do other people who are not pagans do spells?
Yes,
yeah, they absolutely
they
do.
All right, so then you're not above, if somebody comes to you and tells you, I don't know, what kind of story, you know, some sad, scary story that puts you on their side, and they want a spell to cause somebody else great grief, you're not beyond telling them how to do it?
Well, I'm going to warn them, though. And I'm going to tell them, yeah, you might want to think about this. I'm not going to do it for them. I will sell them the components with which to do it, and I will send them away with a warning. And then their karma is in their own hands.
I feel the same way. I warn people about shows like this, and if they don't want to listen,
the time.
Then they can go away.
That's
no
right.
problem.
That's right.
All right, very good. On Skype, Zarakhan, is that right?
Yeah, that's me.
Zarakhan, welcome to the program. If you have a device, extinguish it, please, and go ahead.
Yeah, I just wanted to say hello to Tish. I'm one of her, I'm the producer, actually, of the radio show that she's on, Green Egg Radio.
Oh, really?
Sure is. How you doing, hon?
I'm doing well. Feeling a lot better, dear.
Yeah.
And I wanted to say to our friend in Portland that you have not talked to a witch until you talk to Tish.
Yeah.
And she knows her stuff very well.
I appreciate that.
All right.
I apologize for the echo. I can hear it.
Yep, a little bit, but it's all right. And it's good to hear from you. And so you're saying to our friend in Portland, you don't know what you're talking about.
Absolutely.
All right. That I like. Thank you very much for the call. And
nice to have defenders.
Well, it's always nice to have defenders, is right.
That's right.
Let's go here to, I think, Felton, California, somewhere in California.
Oh, hi. Me?
You, yes.
Hi. Hello, Tish.
Hello. How are you?
I'm fine. I'm Joy. Art. Good evening.
Good evening.
I just wanted to let you know that I used to be a former editor of the Green Egg, too.
Oh, wow.
Hot dog, okay.
And my husband was the original editor. He actually did a mimeograph back in the 60s.
The Green Egg, what is that anyway? It's a publication, right?
It's a publication. It's Pagan Magazine. It's the oldest one.
The oldest one that ever existed.
Existed.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah. The Green Egg was originally the, I guess, the brainchild of Oberon Zell. Now he's called Oberon. He was Tim Zell originally. And he created this magazine, which was the first pagan publication ever.
All right, listen. Do you want to hold on? We've got a break, short break coming up. You want to hold on?
Sure.
All right. Everybody, hold tight. This is Midnight in the Desert as we get closer and closer to dead air. keeps it real. I nominate her to be the House Witch. That's a very high nomination. We could call her the Bell Witch. Somebody else says, Teresa says, great, perfect, actually, for Halloween. And so there you go, getting better and better. So, Tish, you're back on, and caller, you're back on, too. Welcome.
Hi.
Hi.
I actually want to actually say, yes, I would like her to be the official Art Bell Witch.
You too, huh?
Yeah. Well, I'll tell you why.
Why?
Because she is a witch with a conscience. Or conscious. I like you, Tish. I would love to meet you sometime.
I'd love to swap stories. And I got a note because I checked Facebook in the break, and from the editor the editor of Green Egg, and she said to remind everybody that Green Egg is 47 years old.
That's right. That's right. And my husband used to be one of the original editors, and he actually helped establish the Church of All Worlds, which started Green Egg magazine.
Right.
And Oberon is opening a new place here in Santa Cruz.
Right.
And I don't know if Art Bell wants to know about that or not, but it's going to be the Academy of Arcana.
Really?
Yes. It's going to be basically a Hogwarts school.
It's witchy stuff, too. It's awesome.
Yeah, and I'm going to be down there on Thursday helping unpack and getting him all set up.
Give him a big kiss for me, please.
All right.
I will. I mean,
all right, okay. We've got to move on.
And he said he wanted you to say hello. He wanted to say hello to you.
Okay.
Okay.
All right. Thank you very much for the call, and please feel free to call us again. Let's go to Skype. You're on the air with Tish. Hi. Yes.
It's a pleasure, mate. I just want to let you know that I'm just up in a village in Canada here, and I wanted to test whether or not she'd be good to be the resident Bell Witch. Got myself a bit of a problem here. My girlfriend's a bit of a witch herself. She's an ornithomancer. Fortunately, she's in the other hamlet doing a divination. So, miss, I have a question for you. My cows are wheezing. She won't rise from the barn floor. Pus is streaming from her snout. She's the last cow we have in the old hamlet. Winter's coming soon. If we don't have the milk, we're good as dead. Tell me, what can I mix together to help the cow? She won't rise from the barn floor.
You need cow's milk, and you need honey, and you need to mix it up and give it to her warm.
Really?
Is there a particular time of night? Because my girlfriend, like I said, she's a bit of an ornithomancer. This isn't her cup of tea, but should I draw water from a well at a spring at midnight, or will the milk and the honey warm? Will that be enough?
I think so, but you can draw water from the spring at midnight if you want to. That sounds great.
Are you quite sure? Because this is the last cow we've got.
Listen, caller, I want to know how this comes out, all right?
Yeah, let us know.
I will call back another time, and I'll let you know for sure. I really appreciate it. Thank you so much for having a resident witch on.
Good luck
if
with
this works, I think it's good as gold, man. Thank you very much.
Yep, thank you. All right, so that leads me to this, and if the answer is yes, I like it. Do curses and hexes work any better if they're cast at midnight? Tish?
Sir?
Yeah. Do curses and hexes work any better if they're cast at midnight?
Okay, so can you hear me? Maybe I did something
wrong. I hear
you.
I hear you.
It's not midnight. Because, and that's what people always think, is it's the witching hour. But actually, before the sun comes up, so dusk and dawn, because you are literally between the worlds at moment.
Oh, yeah.
It's not daylight, nor is it dark. You are between the worlds. So if you're going to do whatever you're going to do, that's time to do it.
Well, that's really interesting. There is then more power associated with it. It's more likely to succeed. What?
One of the things that we say when we set circle, that we are standing in a place that is not a place, and in a time that is not a time. We are separate from the world as we do our magic. That's gotcha. One of the things that we Wiccans say when we put circle up. And so it's the same thing. And so I'll tell you a story. There's so much Civil War energy here in around Nashville.
Sure.
There were so many battles fought, and there's so many dead people that are still not at rest. But one of my daughters went to school in Murfreesboro, which is down the road about 45 minutes, and she was coming home. She'd only been there about a week or so. She was coming home. She was coming up the back road, and she called me and she said, "So are you familiar with this Stones River battlefield place?" And I said, "Well, yes, as a matter of fact, I am." And she said, "Oh my God, it's so haunted." And she has an affinity. She sees dead people. And so she's driving along the back road. It is dusk and they're all waving at her. Okay. Mm-hmm. And I said, "Well, you have two choices. You can either A, not come home that way, or B, don't come home that way at dusk." So, there's your story.
Are ghosts real?
Yes.
Are ghosts the spirit of, humans that were alive and well at one point? And
yes. Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Absolutely.
Okay. Are ghosts in their situation permanently, or is it just something that happens until they realize they're dead and they need to move on, or? What is their status?
Did you see the movie The Sixth Sense?
I did.
Great movie. A lot of times, and that, like, let's talk about the guys, the Civil War guys, died violently, died in battle.
Right.
Still hanging out because nobody has gone and said, you need to turn around, walk in the light, and go to be moving on. And so they're kind of stuck. There are a lot of, we had a ghost on 2nd Avenue, in one of the shops that I occupied, and she stood on the staircase, and by doing the research, we found out that she had fallen from the staircase and broken her neck. She knew she was dead. She was afraid to go on. She was terrified of us when we moved in, which is kind of funny when you think about it. So she was afraid of us because she was afraid we would send her on, and she was scared to go. So our deal with her is, don't scare the customers, and we won't send you on, which we didn't, and she didn't, and we had a very happy, she's still there, by the way, because
really?
Nobody has sent her on. And so.
Is it really a matter of somebody having to send her on? I had a guest last night virtually saying the same thing. Or, is it just a matter of, I don't know, something has to be settled within that spirit itself to be able to move on?
Right. Why are they still here? And so, and then too, I don't know the answer to this. Pardon me, but I'll throw it out there anyway. In my family, when someone in my family passes, my grandfather shows up to take them to the other side. And so I guess my question is, everybody doesn't have that. They don't all have this patriarch that comes and shows up and goes, come on, it's this way. You're going to be fine. For everyone that has died in our family, he showed up. So there wasn't any confusion or I'm lost, but violent death and sudden death, very often they're so confused about the situation that they're kind of stuck. They're kind of lost. And so, yeah, it's a matter of, sometimes they just need a little push in the right direction.
Got it. All right. Let us go... internationally, and say hello there. You're on the air with Tish. Where are you?
Hello, Tish. I'm calling from Australia. How are you going?
We're doing quite well. And wow, thanks for calling. That's very cool.
My absolute pleasure. And how are you doing, Art?
I'm fine.
Excellent, excellent. Look, I have a question and a comment for Tish. So you've expressed that reincarnation, or you believe in reincarnation, and it's a general consensus that psychic ability is something that you inherit from your parents. So my question is, if you've been reincarnated and you do take things from your past life across to your next one, how come everyone is at sort of a different or a skewed psychic ability position at the moment?
Okay, so here's my theory. I think that everybody has psychic ability. I think that many people are afraid of it, or they don't know it, or they don't know what it is, or they kind of blow themselves off, I knew I shouldn't have turned there, I knew that, I did anyway. And And I think that in my particular life, it was very convenient that I had a grandmother who was extremely psychic. And so I was not raised thinking it was weird or that it was different or that it was bad. And so I feel like because of that, I could expand more as far as my psychic gifts.
Yeah, and, yeah, okay.
But I think that everybody is a little different. You know, like I was just talking about my daughter who really does have an affinity. She says dead people love her. And so she has an affinity that not everybody has. I occasionally can see dead people. I can certainly hear them and feel them. She can just see them standing there. She has more talent in that. And there's different kinds of, you know, there's clairaudient and there's clairvoyance. And so you see them or you hear them or you smell things that nobody else does. And so I think we all have different talents.
Okay, so this I'm sorry, caller. This caller is right. Psychic ability is transferred genetically on down.
I don't know if it's genetic. I know that my grandmother was very psychic, and she didn't discourage me, and she would, you know, and she would, when I would say, oh, I knew that was going to happen, she would say, and isn't it wonderful that you knew that? So I got that kind of encouragement, and I've encouraged my own children to not be afraid of it. And so whether it's genetic or environmental, and maybe both.
All right.
Okay, so it sounds like it's something that you sort of need to blossom or be encouraged to grow into.
Well, I think that you need, you know, I think that you, if you're going to explore your gifts, I think you certainly have to. I think you have to meditate and go to classes and talk to like-minded people and read the right books and, you know, do the homework.
Terrific. Oh, and just with reincarnation, and we did mention how there's plenty of new souls about, I actually had an earlier thought that kind of makes a little bit of sense to me. If we put sort of a quantum mechanics kind of spin on it, objects can be in multiple places at once, but once observed, they're only in a single location. So if you're having multiple lives, potentially you're experiencing them at once, but your consciousness is only at one point in time. Something interesting I thought about, anyway. What are your thoughts?
That might be above my pay grade.
All right. Thank you, caller. Appreciate it. Above your pay grade, eh?
Maybe. And then if that's true, is there a life somewhere where I'm, like, rich and thin? Because that would be cool.
You know, for what you are, I think you're absolutely perfect. I wouldn't touch anything.
Oh, thanks.
Let's go to the phone. Hello there. You're on the air with Tish.
Hi, my name's Shane. I'm calling from Salt Lake City.
Hello there.
Hi, I would just like to know, is there a possibility of finding out someone who could help with the hypnotherapy that you were talking about earlier in the location here where I live?
You mean somebody? Well, what are you talking about? Are you wanting to have somebody regress to a prior life? Is that what you mean?
Yes. I'm very interested in that. I'm just wondering how a person could go about finding someone locally that could do that or was qualified to do that.
I don't know anybody there, but I would tell you to, you know, look on the internet. And you've got to be careful. You want that they're certified. It's really good if they have their own practice or they work out of a shop. That to me makes them a little more legit. Look at their credentials before you let them put you under.
Mm-hmm.
But I'll bet you there's somebody out there in that neck of the woods. I mean, that's not a little town or a little area. You know, check metaphysical shops if there are any, or maybe even herb shops.
Okay.
All okay. Right.
Well, thank I mean, you got to be you got to be careful, caller. You know, you go to the wrong person, and you'll get a call like at midnight or something, and there'll be a key word said, and you'll be doing a naked dance in the middle of town square.
that's my favorite trick to play on people.
Oh gosh! All right, thank you for
I
the
love
call.
Love your show, and thank you very much.
Take care.
Thank you.
So those kinds of post-hypnotic suggestions are viable? They work?
I don't know. They might in the moment. My post-hypnotics are that you'll remember all of this.
Right.
That you'll get more bits and pieces of it and make a more rich picture, if you will. And these things that you've seen and observed will help you to make your life a better place to be living in.
So here's a question. If you go back to a very violent place where you, for example, had a very violent death in a past life.
I've had several of those.
Yes, I understand. Is it always beneficial to know and remember those things, or could it be detrimental to remember it and sort of experience PTSD or something? Of course,
well,
I guess that's what they're having in the first place, and that's why they come to you.
Right, but that's why you give all the pre-hypnotics and post-hypnotics coming in and out. And a lot of times, if there was a reason or that somebody, you know, made you die for whatever reason, then I think it is beneficial to see why that happened and what to do next or how to resolve it. But if because you were a guy with a sword and you were fighting for the king and you got, you know, blown up by a, you know, treasure, what is it? Anyway, somebody dropped a rock on your head. Then I don't know that it's beneficial, but it might give you an idea of why you're afraid of rocks falling out of the sky.
Sure might. I'm afraid of rocks falling out of the sky.
All the time.
Thousands of miles an hour. Josh, welcome to the program on Skype. You're on the air.
Hey, Art. Dead air. Love it.
Thank you.
And Tish, come back. See us often, please.
Well, thanks.
My question, Art's talked about this on a couple other shows, OBEs, out-of-body experiences, good, bad, recommended, what's your take on those?
Good one.
I like them. I think that, I don't know that they're bad. I can't imagine why there would be because, you know, no matter what, you can't be fearful that you're not going to come back to your body because you're going to snap back into your body. And a lot of times when you're doing it, when you're doing it out of body, you snap back into your body too soon. You're like, oh, man, I wasn't finished.
My thing, I think Art felt this too. Like, I used to think they were garbage. Started listening to a couple shows Art's done on it. And then all of a sudden I'll wake up and I'm at that state where there's a vibration and I get freaked out and I'm like, whoa. And I get freaked out and I somehow call it off.
Right.
So
Same here.
What I mean by bad. Like, I get scared when I'm ready to go, I guess.
Well, it's kind of, I mean, it's a little daunting, but have you ever woken yourself up falling back into your body? Because that's
no.
Kind of
my... Oh, you mean that sudden feeling of falling, that incredible, terrible feeling of falling.
Exactly.
Oh, yeah, I've had that.
I have, too.
Oh, yeah.
Well, that's you falling back in your body is what she's saying.
Right. Right.
Oh, okay.
And it wakes you up and you're like, oh my gosh.
Okay.
What just happened?
That's very interesting. I didn't know that. Thank you very much, Colin. Next time, push through it and see if you can actually get out, because that's when the fun starts.
I hope so.
That is when the fun starts. I have somewhere in my house an old tape.
Yes.
Videotape, and gosh, I now wish I could tell you the name, but it was it's a practice for doing exactly that, for out of body. And so there were some, you know, had some friends over. What do you do on Saturday night? Well, we practice trying to get out of our bodies. Most people play cards and eat pizza.
Right.
But so we were doing it. We said, okay, let's go to a place. Let's use all these techniques, to go to a place that we agree on. Well, in those days, I was on 2nd Avenue, which is in downtown Nashville, or my shop was, and we stayed open until midnight because the tourists warranted being open till midnight. And so we did, and we just kind of, visualized ourselves there. And I had a bird I've always had a bird in the shop. So I had a bird, and we kind of freaked the bird out. So the bird is, carrying on. And so a few minutes later, we came back and we're like, okay, and I saw her and she's wearing a black dress and it's kind of short. So we were comparing notes on what we had seen, and the phone rang, and it was the girl that worked at my shop until midnight who called to say, what have you done?
Really?
Yeah, it was great. I'm like, well, we tried an experiment because the bird is going crazy and we felt like somebody was staring at us. And I'm like, well, okay, well. And so next time when you do that, you need to call us and warn us that you're doing that.
Mm.
Okay, I'm sorry.
All right, so
I
would think the chief things that people would come to you for would be love,
yep,
money,
yep,
and revenge.
Yeah, maybe so. Getting even. How do I get even with them? And so, you know, from a logical point of view, which I'm not really a logical person, even though I am a triple Virgo, but my logic says, okay, the universe will take care of it. You don't need to get revenge, you know?
I don't know if I believe that.
Why do you want to throw yourself in the, you know, under that bus? So, but love and money, absolutely. But more people come to me who have been hurt, and they just want to understand why this other person hurt them.
No, see, I don't want to throw myself under the bus. I want to throw somebody else under the bus.
Well, I've been there with you, and I've wanted to throw people under the bus, too.
Let's go with number one.
I have a candle that I make, and it's called Karma Balance.
Oh.
Oh, baby.
Really? So in other words...
Don't burn it. I'm sorry.
In other words, burning that candle and doing associated things...
Yes.
Will cause what's going to eventually occur anyway to occur a little sooner, perhaps?
A little sooner, a little faster, and you might get to see it.
Cool.
But I also say, you know, make sure your own nose is clean before you put this in. You know what I'm, you know?
Yes, I do.
Okay, so. Right.
So let's back up now to love. It's a biggie, and I would never in a million years deny that. In fact, a bunch of questions on the wormhole that I get here are about love. Art, how is it possible for me to get back my ex-girlfriend, for example? They're asking.
Okay. You are, well, we started at the very beginning of the show, you are dealing with somebody else's free will.
Right.
And so it's very, very difficult. You know, you can do a whole lot of stuff for yourself because it's you and you're working on it. But to try and bend somebody else to where you want them to go is more difficult. And then my question always, do you want to live with a person knowing that the only reason they're with you is because you did a spell and the relationship is false?
Tish, a lot of people are going to say, I don't care.
And
yes,
they do. I don't care.
That's right. They're going to say that. So let me ask this. The Bible says, I believe, that God gave us free will. Can Tish take it away?
No.
Yeah.
I can't. Eventually, you know, it's like if you put a bucket of water in a metal bucket and it's fine for a long time, but eventually the seams are going to give and it's going to come out. So sooner or later... the free will is going to resurface. I mean, I guess unless you did a spell every full moon to keep whatever you've got going on continuing to go on, which I think that's feasible.
Oh, it is feasible. All right. You're going to get a lot of people very excited by that one on Skype.
Oh, golly.
Hello there.
Okay.
Hello.
Hello?
Yes.
Hi.
All right. First of all, you're 5 miles away from the microphone, so whatever it is you're using, find the little pinhole microphone and get really close to it to talk to us, okay?
Okay. Can you hear me?
No, not the right pinhole.
Sorry. Maybe this just isn't going to work. Sorry about that.
Well, it's going to work, but you just got to figure out where the mic is. What are you using?
Oh, just my laptop.
Okay. See, your laptop, usually around the top.
Yeah.
There's going to be a place if you get close to the top, near where you see a little hole, and talk there. It's going to sound way better.
Oh, yeah. Okay. No? Better?
Better.
Okay. All right. So I was wondering more on the topic of free will.
Right.
Yeah. So you said that that's temporary? What happens?
Well, the tearing apart of free will to accomplish a goal like keeping somebody would eventually wear off, I think, is what you said. Right, Tish?
Yeah, I think it erodes.
Okay. So then, like, what would happen after that? Would they just start hating the person who cast that spell on them?
Well, no, they might just pack up and leave.
Interesting.
Which is what they were going to do in this first place.
But she also said that if it begins to erode, you can do another one and keep them around, apparently, until you're sick of them.
That's,
you can't
that's,
stand
yeah,
it
strange.
Anymore.
All right.
So you would, okay, caller, as long as I've got you.
Yep,
you,
okay.
Would you cast such a spell?
You know, I, yeah.
Oh, come on, tell the truth.
Yeah, I do it.
Yeah, you do it.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, see? Okay, very good. I you get points for being honest. Thank you.
Yeah, all right.
Right, thank you. That's how strong love is. I mean, let's face it, Tish. People fall in love. They get so enamored, so out of their mind, crazy over somebody that they would say, sure, I don't care if it's a spell. I'll make him love me eventually or her, whatever, right? And,
right.
And I understand that draw, that pull. It's very, very strong. One of the strongest emotions a human being can have.
Absolutely. And so can I put another little codicil here?
Sure.
There are people who will tell you, oh, I can make your boyfriend, girlfriend, wife, whatever, come back to you. I can do it. I can cast the spells. It will cost you, you know, $20 gazillion. Here's the thing. When I said that spells were fueled by emotion, no one else can put the kind of emotion into a spell that you can. I'll be happy to sell you candles, and I'll make you a spell kit. Not happy, but I'll be like, yeah, you sure you want to do this? But I won't do it for you because, well, first of all, I'm not going to get mixed up in your karma, A. And B, I can't put the kind of energy into it. So, yes, yeah, so all the people that send me emails tomorrow that want spells about love, you know.
There's going to be a bunch of them. So, in other words, you're not going to do it for them, but
no.
You will provide them with the things and
yes.
The instructions to
right.
Put themselves in that position if that is absolutely what they want.
If they absolutely have to have it, and, you know, I might add a cautionary tale or two, but, you know, ultimately we all make our own karma, right?
Well, as I said, Tish, most of these people are so in love, crazy in love.
Right,
they,
I understand.
They don't care. They don't care. And so you're right. You're going to get a lot of emails, a lot of phone calls, and you're saying you'll deal with them.
I'll deal with them.
Gotcha. Hold it right there.
I am.
All right. All right, so... Yeah, she's something, isn't she? Tish Owen is my guest. I'm Art Bell. This is Midnight in the Desert.
Come on, men and women, Skype up. Call Midnight in the Desert at MITD 51. That's MITD 51.
gotta love that, actually, Skype up. All right, so my guest is a witch, Tish Owen, and very, very interesting witch at that. Somebody from Colorado named Joe wants to know, so Tish, what did you do for Dell Computers?
Oh, I worked a convention.
Uh-huh.
And did readings at a convention because when you have trade shows, you want people to come to your booth.
Oh,
and
sure.
So that was, we did that. We did the same thing for the Atlantic Sea Tourism Board, and that was a convention, a trade show for the Dish Network, Satellite Networks, Dishwork Network. And so they wanted people to come to there. We were advertising Penny Dreadful for them.
Okay. So you weren't hetzing Hewlett Packard or something?
No. You know,
because they did have a problem. And
they did, but I think their problem was Carly Farina. Oh, did I say that? Was that my outside outlet? Oh,
gosh, that was great. Sean on Skype, you're on the air with Tish. Hello.
Oh, hi, Art.
Hi.
I didn't think I would actually get on, but
appreciate
you.
When you dial, you've got to always imagine that.
All right. Well, I guess my question would be, what direction would you recommend someone who has the potential for the crafts and natural abilities? Because I've always felt fear from exploring that. That's side of my soul?
It's actually a good question. Yes.
Of what are you fearful?
Okay, put it this way. I come from a family of, people in my bloodline who have a lot of power, and I don't know how else to put it because I'm first generation in the United States.
Right.
And my mom, she is all but psychic, and she actually doesn't recommend that I, go into that world, and I just always feel fear, from to explore the unknown.
But okay, so a couple of things. One, it's not going to leave you alone. The psychic is not going to leave you alone. The psychic energy is just going to keep pushing till you finally go, okay, fine. So right. Training is good, and also to understand that this is natural. It's like being left-handed or being able to play the piano by ear or any of those kinds of things. It is part of your talent and ability, mm-hmm. and there is nothing to fear. And because you're a good human, and so you shouldn't be afraid of the power. You're not going to do anything to misuse it.
Right.
I'm
okay.
Yeah, I see what you're saying. I just don't know how to overcome that little, it is fear in a way.
It but is. Okay. So you have to work with it and practice, and when nothing blows up, you'll go, oh, wait a minute, this isn't so bad.
Okay. I appreciate that.
Okay, thank you, caller. I have the ability to misuse it, Tish.
Well, then, Art, you and I are going to have to sit and have a long talk about that.
Okay, to the phones we go, and hello, you're on the air. And noisy.
Hello?
Yeah, there is your voice. Hi.
Hi. Am I on the phone, on the line?
You are.
Oh, I want you to know I'm one of those people that the church people that came up there to see her. I relocated from Sacramento, and I relocated to Phoenix City, Alabama.
Mm.
And just across the river is Columbus, Georgia. And there's a movie called The Phoenix City Story, and if you actually see this movie, you will see that when it first come on, it'll tell you there are more churches there per capita than any place in the country. And I'm going to tell you, you have these different statuses. In all of these churches, you're going to have people who are educated and people who are not educated. And the people who are well-educated and well-entrenched in these churches and in every denomination. And they actually practice. And again, when we look at the Bible, you will see that it is good and evil. And it tells you that that area is the Bible Belt.
It is the Bible Belt. Are you telling us that people in churches are practicing either black magic or witchcraft? Is that what you're saying?
Without a doubt. And the thing I'm saying is, they actually use the same Bible that the Christian who are really Christians and the people, again, Jesus is the God that we're serving. And you will see where in the Bible they said put the blood upon the doorposts, and they actually had for the Passover. Death actually passed over your house.
Okay, I'm sorry, but we're short on time, so you're going to have to get to the point here.
Well, the point I'm making is it's very prevalent, and I'm a victim or a survivor of that, but at the same time, all of your listeners, when she was calling about protection, that's 91 Psalms. So when you are, I know.
Like so you're, excuse me, you're a victim of what?
People constantly using witchcraft, and it's very, very, very prevalent.
Okay, so you are saying that people in churches representing their Christianity or showing it off are using witchcraft and black magic. That is actually an interesting observation, Tish. A lot of that going on?
I don't know. I don't go to church, Art.
Good answer. Nevertheless,
I don't know. I think that a lot of people use magic that are not pagans, Wiccans, witches, and again, we come back to the karma thing. I mean, people are mean or not mean, or good or bad, no matter what they are, what religion, not a religion, atheists, pagans. And so you're going to have good and bad and people who are not ethical.
Yeah, that's right.
If they think that gives them power to do that, then I'm not terribly surprised by her statement. I am disappointed.
Well, I'm not surprised. I mean, even these good church-going folk, when they get up against the wall with something, might be inclined to turn to whatever they think will work.
Might be, yes, indeed. I would agree with that.
Scott on Skype, you're on the air with Tish. Hi.
Hi, great show.
Thank you.
So, talking about the out-of-body experience thing, 10 years or so ago, I had a couple of out-of-body experiences and kept waking up at night, feeling vibrations and stuff, and it scared the horse poo out of me. And so I, one night when I was having these vibrations and it was disturbing my sleep, I sat up in bed and said, just leave me alone out loud. And I never had it since then. But then I started having trouble sleeping where it feels like I'll fall asleep and it's like I'm nodding off. And you talked about feeling like you're falling and waking up from that.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like I'll wake up like I've been nodding off and, you know, falling type of thing over and over and over again to where I have to take sleeping pills for it. So is that related then to the out of body thing? Do you think,
I think you scared yourself so badly that you're doing it unconsciously, obviously unconsciously, but subconsciously, and I think that probably is you falling back into your body. So, you know, I mean, things that you try and fight, they will surface eventually.
So what would I do to try and get out of that?
God, that is an hour long question or answer. I think that the sleeping pills thing is not the best idea. I think that you need to come to terms with that this is not something that's going to harm you. And that you should do some things to get into a relaxed state before you get into bed, instead of going 400 miles an hour all day long and taking Ambien and then laying down and going to sleep. I think that, you know, the kind of routine that we had when we were kids, and we got a warm bath and we got a story and we got some milk. Which is all telling your subconscious to slow down. We're going to sleep now. That I feel like that would help you.
That's good.
It ain't magic, but you know what? I think it will work. So
I'll give that a try.
Yeah, thanks. Give it a try and let me know how it works, caller.
Yeah, okay. We'd love to hear it. Right. Okay. Awesome. Okay.
Thanks, Scott. I'm that way, Tish. If something is, I'm a real A-type personality, and if I get stressed, I cannot sleep. And I can take strong sleeping pills.
Right.
I can take some combination of stuff, everything to put you to sleep, and trust me, my mind will not let me sleep. The medications don't make a damn bit of difference.
That's why I think most of us have the same issue, can't turn your brain off.
That's right. That's right.
So I'm going to give you a suggestion.
I'm listening.
Okay.
Warm milk.
You lay down, you can't sleep, and you're tossing and turning. I just want you to breathe, and I want you to breathe in through your nose four, one, two, three, four. Hold it, one, two, three, four. Exhale, one, two, three, four. And it will relax you, and it will also give you something to concentrate on besides all the stuff that's driving you crazy.
Sound like
you can't count and breathe.
You sound like a breathing drill sergeant.
I'm a breathing coach now, but it really does. It really does work. I promise.
All right. Let's go to Jackson, Tennessee. Hey, that'd be close to you, I suppose.
Ooh, down the road. Yeah.
Hello.
Hello, Art. Wonderful show.
Thank you.
Tish, I would like to know two things. I'm a little bit agnostic about spells and hypnotism. Would it be possible would it be possible for somebody to hypnotize me if I don't totally believe in it, or put a spell on me if I don't really believe in it?
Right.
See, I think that a lot of times with spells, hexes, curses, it's really helpful if the person that you're spelling, cursing, or hexing believes in it, so you can, you know, they can buy into it and suck that energy up. But is it possible? Yes, it is possible.
Okay, that's a big one. So in other words, whether or not the person, yeah, it's helpful if they believe in it, but it's not an absolute must.
Right, or that they know it's coming, or they're intimidated by it, or whatever. But no, it's not an absolute must. As far as the hypnosis, though, I got to tell you, the more open and receptive you are, you have to feel safe in this process.
Right.
And if you go in going, I don't know about that, I don't like this, it makes me whatever, it's going to be really tough to put you under. Mm-hmm. So.
Very good, I thought so. I have one more question.
Sure.
We've talked about curses, hexes, spells. Most of those carry a negative connotation. Is it possible to put a spell, a curse, a hex on somebody that has a positive spin for the recipient?
Okay. Yeah, curses and hexes, not so much. Spells, and, you know, I wrote this little book about spells, and you have to look at the karma, always the karma. And so, yes, if you've got your cousin and or your brother or your whatever, and they're a drug addict, and so to do a spell for sobriety and for clarity, then yes, I think that does have positive, even though you really are working against somebody's free will. It's their free will to take that pill or shoot up that heroin or whatever it is. But I think that's a positive. At least, at the very least, you're throwing some positive energy at it, okay?
All right. Well, let's go overseas to Marto, wherever he is. Marto, where are you? Hello, Marto. Well, unfortunately, Marto left the line. That's too bad. Let's go to the phone, and you're on the air with Tish. Hi. Hello?
Testing.
Marto said testing, so he wasn't ready to go on the air. On the phone line, hello. Going once?
I just wanted to recommend that you name your Halloween show Mid-Fright in the Desert.
Not happening. Not happening. It's dead air.
Mid-Fright.
Dead air.
Mid-Fright in the Desert.
Dead air.
And on your words.
Dead air. Dead air. Yeah.
I feel like I need a duck. I feel like I'm having words thrown over my head.
Hello there on the phone line. You're on here. Hello?
Hello?
Hello.
Hi. I have a question.
Okay.
How do you know if you have witch blood in you?
Mixed blood? Did you say mixed
witch
blood?
No, she said witch blood.
Witch blood. Witch blood. Okay.
Yeah, I don't know that you have witch blood in you. I think that's a choice, like every, you know, other things, if you were going to be a Presbyterian or not. And so, is there a tendency? Do you have family? Do you have hereditary? You hear people talk about being a hereditary witch. Okay. Pardon. So I don't know that there's such a thing as having witch blood in you.
One thing you don't want is witch blood on your hands.
No, absolutely not. Or on your feet or anything else. That's bad. But I think that you can do some work and look at practicing.
Okay. You okay there, caller?
I'm sorry.
Yes.
Quite all right.
Okay. Supposedly, if I turn up my microphone, you can't hear me, but apparently that doesn't work.
Well, there is a mute function on Skype. Skype's wonderful. It makes that's what makes you sound like you're right here. Caller, anything else?
I come from a family that can see things, sense things, basically like psychic ability.
Right.
You mean like I see dead people?
Yeah.
and some of that, I think some of that, if you want to talk about heredity, I think that's what we're talking about.
Mm-hmm. I'm so glad I don't see dead people.
It's kind of fun.
See, that's why you're a witch.
Kind of flip, but I didn't mean it that way. But it's cool.
All right, we're so out of time. One quick question for Portland, Oregon. I'm sorry all the people waiting that aren't
listening.
Yes.
I have a neighbor who I've lived where I live for 6 years. This woman has been she lives right below me.
Yes.
And she's just been obsessed with my life. And I didn't realize until, maybe 2 years had passed that she was passing along things to my property manager about these allegations. She's got company all the time. She's selling drugs. She's single. She's a prostitute.
Okay. So really quick, can I tell you what to do?
But
really quick.
Okay, now listen.
Really quick. Okay. A little bottle.
To protect.
Put her name on it. Put 7 pinches of salt, 7 cloves, fill it up with water, put it in the freezer.
You're talking, you can't listen and talk at the same time.
Okay.
Start again, Tish. Go ahead. Tell her again.
A little bottle, put her name on a piece of paper, roll it up, put it in the bottle, 7 cloves, 7 pieces of salt, fill it up with water, put it in the freezer. She's done.
All right. And if that doesn't work, put a hex on her for a horrible, painful, twitching death.
You know.
Yeah. All right. Well, listen, it's been really my pleasure, Tish, having you on tonight.
It's my pleasure, too.
What a wild night. Thank you very much. And we will do it again sometime.
I want to say happy birthday to Susie Wright.
Happy birthday, Susie. Good night, Tish.
Good night. Thank you so much.
Good night. Okay. I think we may have found our resident witch. I hope you all have a wonderful night, and we will be here once again tomorrow. It's going to be a real dead air kind of week. Good night.
Midnight in the desert. There's wisdom in the air.